Lake Taps is a fantastic spot for boating and swimming, but its frigid water is responsible for drownings nearly every year. Hear from experts about why young men and teens are especially susceptible and what you should do if you suddenly need help. All that is coming up right now on Pierce County Talks. Lake Taps is one of Pierce County's most popular lakes for boating and swimming. When the weather heats up, this place is packed. Before we talk about life-saving information if you're going to be swimming here, let's first meet a few members of the Marine Patrol crew who keep everyone safe on the lake.
We're looking for anybody that is going too fast close to shore or other boats. We're looking for registration decals to see if they're current. That's a big ticket, $257 if you're expired.
Patrolling the water is a lot like patrolling on land.
We're going to take you to Fairweather Cove. That was one of the big partying areas where people would misbehave when they were intoxicated.
The Pierce County Sheriff Marine Patrol Unit has a lot of ground to cover on Lake Taps.
We used to sit a boat here and watch all the people rafting and partying and try to keep control of it with 50, 60, 100 boats in here if it's a warm day. Now it's pretty much empty.
These people pay a lot of money and they live on the lake and they don't want to be bothered by these people partying.
But most of the time, they're not handing out tickets. It's more education than it is enforcement.
Just telling people what the laws and the rules are, because they've grown up on the water and they just don't know anymore, and things evolve and they don't keep up to date on it.
They've seen too many accidents and collisions on the water.
How you doing? Good, yourself?
Good.
I'm Sergeant Brian Ward. This is Deputy Chad Fox. We stopped because you looked like you were within 100 feet of that boat.
Okay.
You do have to stay 100 feet back when you're jumping wakes.
Yes, sir.
A quick contact is an opportunity to make sure it's a safe, fun day on the lake for everyone.
If he was pulling a skier, how far back do you have to be jump wakes?
Probably 500.
300 feet.
Today, it's just a reminder.
On any given Saturday or Sunday on the weekend in the summer, this lake is packed. I mean, there are hundreds of boats, hundreds of jet skiers. It gets very, very rough out here.
They know that we're out usually on the weekends, 11 to 7, and then if we have a second boat, it'll be out usually 1 o'clock until 9 p.m.
They'll often find people jumping off the low bridges.
You're not supposed to jump.
Yep, nice day, I'm not gonna jump.
All right, well, have fun.
Thank you.
Or not wearing life jackets.
Didn't forget the beer, but forgot the life jackets?
No, I grabbed the beer.
Okay, of course, right? You just have to have life jackets on board
right.
And a whistle.
Okay, okay. We're heading back.
Where's the house at?
It's right down that way.
Okay.
They also do inspections at the dock in Lake Taps North Park.
This is brand new, looks like.
Yeah, they
beautiful.
It's a good time to talk with boaters before they even hit the water. Make sure they have all the safety gear and paperwork they're supposed to have. You can't beat the backdrop at this popular spot for picnicking and sunbathing. It's easy to see why people flock to Lake Taps to beat the heat. And for those headed out on the water, know the rules. The Sheriff Patrol boat will be out there all weekend.
Lake Taps has great public parks, but the one thing people forget about is how cold the water is. It's so cold it's fed by a glacier, and it has caused multiple drownings over the last decade. So before we kick off another summer swimming season, let's learn a little bit more about swimming safety. Joining me today is Sergeant Brian Ward with the Pierce County Sheriff's Department and Todd Green with the Bonney Lake Police Department. Thanks for being here today.
Thanks for having us.
Let's talk a little bit about what people can do if they're coming out for a general day on the lake, if they're gonna boat or swim. What do they need to bring with them and think about?
Generally, they need to make sure that they have all the safety equipment required. If they have young children, they should have life jackets. There's also a loaner program with East Pierce Fire here at Lake Taps where they can borrow a life jacket and return it when they're done. When they're on the boat, they want to make sure they have a life jacket that fits every person on board so that if there's many adults and a few children, there's also life jackets for children that will fit them. They want to make sure they have their mandatory boater's education card with them. They should have taken a test which explains the type of safety equipment they need, whether it's fire extinguisher, whether it's a flare if you're way out in the lake, whether it's throwable life preserver to help someone. We've actually had a fire within the last 2 years on the lake, so the person that had the fire, was surrounded by boats that had fire extinguishers and helped put out the fire. So it does happen. Those kind of safety things are required. And then, of course, the sunscreen for the kids.
We're here at Lake Taps County Park, and there's Allen York Park as well. They both get packed during the summer. But what do people not know about the water and the temperature?
Well, one thing, I mean, kind of touched on it a little bit earlier, is one thing about the Pierce County or Lake Taps in general is Lake Taps is a glacier-fed lake. So all the water that came, that is in Lake Taps today, was snow a few weeks back. It comes right off Mount Rainier down the White River, and then we divert some of the water, and that's where the water in Lake Taps comes from. As we know, the weather hasn't been that great currently until the last week or so. So the water hasn't had time to warm up. The water is still very cold. And so when people are, they come out here to have a good time and they think it's an 80 degree day and it's nice and it's time to go swimming, well, what they forget is that water is extremely cold. And so what we see a lot of times is people enter the water and they're just, and they stay in too long. They're not ready for that cold of water and they don't expect it to be that cold. And that's when sometimes people get into trouble, is when they're just in cold water for too long.
We are experiencing one right now, these unusual hot spells between kind of April and June. Why are those early summer warm days most concerning for you?
Well, I have a 12-year-old, and she asked me if she'd go swimming in one of the local lakes in Kitsap County. We live in Gig Harbor. I declined that request because I knew the water was too cold. She's more used to pool swimming. When you get in a lake, the temperature is very shocking. It shocks the system, and even if you get used to it, it causes fatigue. You can put yourself in a bad situation. This early, people take risks. Even on the rivers, they decide to float down a river when it's very cold and running really fast because of the melt, the snow melt. So it's just a good idea to wait until the waters warm up. Start summer and spring a little slow and get into the swing of things. Don't do a quick swim in the middle of April. Not a good idea.
What have been the most common causes of some of the past drownings?
Sadly, that's pretty easy to say. Some of the number one cause is always people swimming over their abilities. We've seen that on the last four or five drownings we've had in Lake Taps. Fortunately, over the last 4 years, we haven't had a lot of drownings. We had one last summer, and then we actually went the entire lake, Pierce County and Bonney Lake, went over 3 years without having a drowning. But the drownings that we have seen, and when, over the last 10 years, have all been very similar. And it's either someone trying to swim too far and they forget they still have to make it back. Someone wondering if they can do something, we hear that a lot. We hear they were wondering if they could make it across the lake. They were wondering if they could make it to the swim area over there. They were wondering if they could make it to the floating dock. And then they try to swim out there, well, they forget they still have to make it back. And their abilities don't allow them to do all that. And so what we were seeing over the years is people will make it out to where their goal was, the buoy, the floating dock, the other side of the swim area, and then they try to make it back and they're exhausted at that point. And that's when they get into trouble and that's when they drown. And the other big one we've seen too is the recovery of sports equipment like baseballs, soccer balls, footballs. As you can see, we're out at Pierce County Park, it's a nice grassy area here. Not uncommon at all to see people out here playing ball and throwing a ball back and forth, and sooner or later that ball's going to end up in the water. And there's always somebody that goes, I'll go get it. They jump out there and they start swimming and they forget that ball just keeps going and going and going and going until they get just too far, and then they go to look back and realize that it's just too far for them to make it back.
Man. Do you, give me a little bit about the statistics of kind of the types of people, maybe age ranges.
I'll give you the demographics.
Yeah, please.
It's usually a male. Mid-teens to early 20s, is out for a day of fun on the lake, maybe didn't plan to go swimming, but gets talked into it, doesn't want to admit to his friends he's not a good swimmer, wants to stay up with his girlfriend or the people he's with, and finds himself in trouble. The county park itself is an alcohol-prohibited park, so they're not supposed to have alcohol. We check the beaches, we check the boats when they come in, and cars when they come into the park. Alcohol is a major contributor to drownings, whether you're on a boat or swimming in a lake.
If someone is in distress, what should they do?
Well, hopefully, when they're in distress, hopefully they planned
better before they got into the water. Once you're in distress, it's almost too late. Your body won't allow you, when you're in distress in the water, to do things like you see on TV. They say drowning is a silent death, and it really is. All the witnesses that we've talked to on drownings, they all say he was there 1 second and he was gone the next. They never saw any splashing water, they never heard anything. So that's why it's very important for that person that's in the water to, you know, plan ahead and make sure that you know, either they have a life jacket on if they're gonna try swimming across, or if they have a life jacket if they're gonna go get a ball. But really, prevention's the number one thing to do, because once you're in distress, you're at a point now where it's almost too late to ask for help.
If they can think quickly, they can turn over onto their back, they can do a frog stroke, or they can do a backstroke, kicking, that kind of thing. But that's a lot to ask someone who's panicking and thinking, I may not make it to shore. So being in distress, turning on your back, if you can then gather your thoughts and call out for help, hopefully you have a swim partner, that you don't swim alone out here, someone who's watching after you, and maybe you can discuss a signal that if I'm in trouble, I'll raise my arm, that kind of thing, so that people are aware. When you're struggling for breath, you can't cry out very, very loudly, if at all. So it is difficult.
If I'm on the beach, if I'm on the picnic areas, and I see someone having trouble, what should I do?
I would ask someone for a cell phone to call 911 to get a diver here as quickly as possible. If someone is a competent swimmer and has a life jacket on, they can make it to the person, try to help them. People who have life-saving certificates deal with people struggling in the water and how to turn them around, get them in front of them, try to control and calm them, and get them back to shore. But it is difficult. In rescuing people from drowning, half the people that actually end up drowning are rescuers. So it's not just the first person, it's the second person, sometimes it's the third person. Sometimes it's the rescuer that drowns and the person makes it back to shore. So it's about 50-50, the initial person in trouble and the rescuer trying to help.
How do I know if my body is telling me the water's too cold, or that my body's being affected in a way that I don't know? You know, what should I pay attention to?
It's very similar signs that you'll see when you are cold out of the water. So, I mean, you'll get, you know, pain in your fingertips, and you'll get blue lips. Your skin will begin to get pale. Those are things that somebody else can see, but the problem is when you're in the water, you don't see that. And then anybody that's ever been in the water for a long period of time, you start realizing that after a while, your body gets accustomed to the water, even if it's cold. Your body will eventually get to that temperature where it feels normal to be in the water and you don't feel cold. And that's where we need people to really take time to get out of the water, warm themselves up. We always tell everybody, especially the children that we talk to about water safety, is, you know, take breaks. Only be in the limit, whether it's a hot day or it's a day like today where it's, you know, probably not swim temperature yet. But once they, you know, when they're in the water, just take a break. Get out and just let your body warm up, and then get back in. And that's when you come out to take a break too, that's a time where you can kind of just check yourself and make sure that, you know, you're not starting to get the onset of hypothermia and stuff like that.
You mentioned the free life vests that people can borrow while they're here. They should bring them with them. How significant is a life vest, both for teens and adults too, not just children?
The life vests are great, but they only work if you're wearing one. And that's the hardest part in our job, is to get people to understand that life jackets, they are awesome, but they only work if you're wearing them, especially with kids. We want to see every kid out here wearing a life jacket. We go around both Pierce County and Bonney Lake. We've tried ice cream coupons, we've tried McDonald's, we've tried everything trying to influence kids to wear their life jackets. But at the end of the day, it really comes down to the parents making them wear their life jackets and the kids wanting to wear their life jackets. So we always tell everybody, make sure you show up with a life jacket that fits properly. Make sure there's no holes in it. And then if you do show up and you have forgotten your life jacket for the day, take advantage of the loaner program. And it's not just Lake Taps that has these. These loaner programs are all over the state. And we would love nothing more to see everybody, that especially children, in a life jacket.
Let's talk a little bit about the training that you both do as being team members who are on a marine patrol. What kind of training do you all do to be prepared both for saving someone and if you have to recover somebody?
First of all, the county takes, and I'm sure the city takes, time to train their officers in first aid, and that includes hypothermia. It includes how to perform CPR if someone has stopped breathing. Just because they've stopped breathing doesn't mean they're not going to make it. Drowning's a process, and if you can catch them within the process and reverse the process back toward being able to breathe, then you can recover the person. We also do swim rescue training at least once every 2 years, usually at a pool, so that we're able to swim a distance, tread water, be able to help someone back to shore, that type. Even fighting with a suspect in the water if someone wants to fight us on the boat. The ways to fight dirty and survive, basically, if someone wants to fight you and put you in the water. So we do that type of training.
And one of the, you know, and although we're two different agencies, we honestly do a lot of training together, and we'll do joint trainings. One of the big things, and you kind of touched on it, was we do, with our purpose as marine officers out here on the boats, is if we roll up onto a drowning that just occurred, we have to get the scene set up as good as the best we can for when the divers arrive. And one of the things that really helps us, and this is, you know, comes back to if you see somebody in distress, is always remember that one point you were standing when you saw this person go under. And we train all of our officers, the second you get there, start asking witnesses that are on the beach, where exactly were you standing when you saw this person go underwater? And that's where we want the person to take us back to that exact location, and then use a reference. You know, it was right in line with that tree across the lake. It was, you know, in line of that house that we can see. It was about, you know, about a football field's away. That's what we're looking for. But the key, we always tell everybody, if you do see somebody in distress too, make sure, throw a rock on the ground, put an X in the ground in the dirt with your foot. Do something that you can take us right to that spot. All the agents, and this is not Pierce County, everybody that shows up that is Marine trained, when we arrive on scene to a drowning, we're gonna ask everybody that saw them, take us right where you were, and we're gonna start interviewing so we can get the divers in the water right there when they get there.
And then lastly, just tell me about your big training day coming up in May and how the public can get involved too.
Well, the big training day in May is, it's still kind of a new process we're doing over the last few years with the Bonney Lake Police Department, Pierce County Sheriff's Department, is we try to get out on the lake and learn how to work together. We do invite other agencies up. This year, I believe we have four other agencies. I believe Kent, Black Diamond's also going to join us when we're out on the lake. The big thing with that is really just what I just talked about, is there's 15 to 20 Marine Service officers in each division or each unit. And so we want them all on the same page. We want them to know how to interview somebody that just saw a drowning. We want them to know where and how to properly put down marker buoys that we have on the boats that'll show where this person possibly went underwater. And then we also teach them shore stuff with the divers so they can help and assist the divers when the divers arrive on scene.
Yeah, that's our May training also. We have two new members coming onto the unit. They're gonna be looking at how to talk to the divers, direct them under the water through comms, how to determine a witness from someone who heard something or a secondhand report so that we can move that person away. Someone who's being unruly, it could be a relative of someone who has gone under, try and get that person away from everyone else so that we can have a scene that can assist the divers when they arrive. Pierce County divers have their equipment in their vehicle. They get here quickly. They're sent an iPhone Everbridge page, and they get here as quickly as they can with their lights and sirens going so that they can try and find the person within the hour that they go down on the chance that they can recover and resuscitate that person.
And East Pierce Fire also has divers on Lake Taps, and so for a drowning on Lake Taps, it's not uncommon to have divers here quickly. The key though is a diver is no good if we can't tell the diver where to go. And that's where we need the witnesses. This lake is huge, very big, and we have to be able to say to the diver, this is where you need to start and this is where you need to go.
Todd, Brian, thank you for being here today.
Thanks
for having us.
We hope you learned a lot today. I'm Megan Hutton with Pierce County Talks. Stay safe.